started things late, we're now ahead of time. So I feel that as well, but, so that she's not standing around and we're not standing for a while, I thought that it would be good for us to start a little bit early, so we would start our day with soon-to-be Dr. Kilgore.
Yes.
As well as ending our day after that wonderful session this morning. We are certainly looking forward to hearing her presentation on the vocal music. Professor Kilgore is again from FAMU and about to finish a doctorate at Florida State, and she brought her accompanist, Lindsay Sargent from FAMU. So we're really looking forward to this last presentation before the concert tonight. Afterward, I hope you all will take a nice break, go get your dinner, relax, and then Hill Hall, for those that have not been here, is the building directly behind us, the auditorium. You'll go straight through that door, and the concert's at 8. We have a wonderful concert, including Professor Taylor. And Karen Walwood playing the piano sonata and some other things. So.
All right, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Welcome again, and once again, it's an honor for me to be here. We will start at the beginning, actually, and then we're going to go just a little out of order. I'm going to do the spirituals first, and then head back up to the top, and we'll talk about the jazz compositions. Margaret Bonds wrote in many styles of songs. She wrote various styles of song. She wrote jazz songs, musical theater songs. She arranged African American spirituals, and she wrote several art songs as well. And as I said this morning, of course, her background had so much to do not so much to do with what she did with her life. And one of the people that influenced her so much was Abby Mitchell. And I did want to read this again, so this may be a repeat for those of you who are here this morning. With Abby Mitchell, then, I had close analysis of all the works of the great composers. And Abby Mitchell premiered the role of Clara in Gershwin's Porgy and Bess in 1935. And she was one of the many guests that showed up at Estella Bonds' home, which was Margaret Bonds' mother. Her husband was Will Marion Cook, and he also was very influential in Margaret Bonds becoming a composer. Margaret began composing art songs in 1932, around 1932. These are the first known art songs first known art songs. Sea Ghost, or Sea Wolf, won first prize in the song category in the Watermaker competition. And these manuscripts, as we learned this morning, are lost, unfortunately. There is another song called Sleep Song with a poetry by Joyce Kilmer, and that was also composed in 1932, and I don't know where that manuscript is either. So when she began to work with Abby Mitchell, she learned so many things about vocal music. Abby Mitchell showed her songs written by Debussy, H.G. Burley, Schubert, all of these really important pieces of art music. And she said from Abby Mitchell, I learned the importance of the marriage between the words and music, which is demanded if one is to have a song of any consequence. And we'll go in order. Here are the jazz tunes. In 1939, Bonds moved to New York, and she said she moved there with $37 in her pocket to begin her career as a composer, and that was from the Washington Post in 1961. She also stated that everyone would look at me and say, look at that poor dopey kid, she wants to be a composer. Well, I did. I made my living on the Tin Pan Alley. And the Tin Pan Alley is the name given to a collection of New York City music publishers and songwriters who dominated the popular music industry in the United States in the late 19th and early 20th century. And when she moved there, she was very lucky because even though she only had $37 in her pocket, she made several hundreds more. And she did so by working with Clarence Williams at his publishing company as she became the rehearsal pianist at the Apollo Theater. And this was a position that was held by Duke Ellington prior to her coming, so it was a very important position. In a letter to Langston Hughes, Margaret writes this, surprisingly, I am never satisfied with my harmonies of popular songs. However, Mr. Ellington is such a clever musician that he will most likely put his own harmony to the melody if he plays it himself. And that was written June 12, 1936. So Langston was actually monumental in introducing her to some of these popular artists as well, because it was through him that she was even corresponding with Ellington, and he was looking at some of her popular songs. I don't know at this time if he ever performed them. I'm assuming that maybe he did, but certainly she was in communication with him. And then in 1939, of course, she wrote Peachtree Street. And let me back up just a minute. Let's see here. Let me talk a little bit about Clarence Williams, because this is pretty significant. Clarence Williams was a jazz pianist. He was a vocalist, a composer, and a theatrical producer. And he was a music publisher. And he began recording with Vocalion Records in 1933. And he was very monumental in he was monumental in that particular recording company, with that recording company. And it was through him that she met several of these other artists. Now, Duke Ellington, of course, was introduced by Langston Hughes, but she met several very, very important artists. And those artists included Andy Razoff and Harold Dickinson. And both of those artists are the lyrics to two of her very popular songs. Before she even moved to New York, however, it's important to note that Jimmy Lunsford and Cab Calloway had already recorded and performed her songs. Cab Calloway had performed a tune called Loving What It Ought to Be in 1936 at the Cotton Club in Harlem. So that was a pretty important, she was already finding success in the popular music realm. So let's move on here and let's look at Peachtree Street. Andy Razoff, let's talk about him first of all. He is the first lyricist that she worked with. And Andy Razoff was already a very famed lyricist in the popular music industry. He worked with Fats Waller, and he wrote the words for Honeysuckle Rose, and he wrote the words for Ain't Misbehaving. So here he was, a giant in the industry already, and he began working with Bonds, and they wrote Peachtree Street. But before we listen to Peachtree Street and talk about that, I'd like to sing just a little bit of Honeysuckle Rose, which was written, the words were written by Andy Razoff. Recorded in December 15th of 1939 on Victor Records. It's also part of the Academy Award-winning film Gone with the Wind. And this is actually the CD. If you, you know, if you want to look at this, I can pass it around. That Peachtree Street is on. And one of the things about Margaret Bonds' works, and this is partly why I wanted to start with the spirituals, but that wasn't the order of the slideshow, is that all of her songs, and even from the very, very beginning, I mentioned this, she wrote Market Street Blues when she was 5 years old. She immediately knew who she was, and she knew what type of music she wanted to write. She always wanted to promote African-American music, and even in her jazz pieces, you can see here forms that derive from the spirituals. Peachtree Street starts with a call and response form, and you can see here in this example, we have When You Want to Reach Me, and then the top line of the piano repeats the same music, one octave, and Just Remember Peachtree, and the piano repeats the same music again. And in the interlude of this particular piece, we have something called stride piano. How many of you are familiar with stride piano? Okay, good, wonderful, all right. So I'm going to have Lindsay play just a little bit of that, the beginning of this interlude, just so that you can hear.
Just me.
was recorded by the Glenn Miller Orchestra, and she collaborated with Harold Dickinson in 1940 to write this song. It's a war protest song. It was during World War II, and it was recorded by the Glenn Miller Orchestra featuring Ray Everly and the Modern Airs on vocals on February 20th, 1941 on RCA Bluebird Records. This particular song is divided into two sections. We have a 12-bar verse section and then a 32-bar chorus, which is fairly common in jazz music. And it's a beautiful piece. One element of Margaret Bonds' art songs is the way in which she set the text. She was always concerned about representing the words through the music. And even in her jazz tunes, you can see examples of this. And usually we see this kind of thing in art music, but here it is that she has this in jazz music as well. This particular phrase right here, a melancholy message, we have a dissonant note there, and then we also, in that first beat, and then here, there is a frown on April's face, we have, again, another dissonant note. The piece is actually in E flat major, but she's using the harmonies to reflect the text, which is something very, it's a characteristic of Margaret Bonds' art songs that appears in almost every single one of her pieces. And so, without any further delay, we're gonna do this piece for you as well. And I think we'll just do the version that Glenn Miller did, and that is just the chorus. There is a verse to this, but we're gonna do it the way the recording is done. Produced by Capitol Records at the Copacabana chose nightly has become a collector's item, but unfortunately, Peggy Lee was not satisfied with the quality of the live recordings done at the Cabana Club, and she re-recorded the concert at Capitol Studios, and the version, I guess the Margaret Bonds' song, didn't make the final cut. So it was written for her, and somewhere there may be a track of that. At this point, the live master is lost. Are there any questions about her jazz pieces at this point? No? Okay, all right. So we're going to move on then, and we're going to skip to the spirituals. And let me just move quickly through this so I can use the PowerPoint, which may make it easier. Okay. All right. Okay, and everybody just moved down to the last section of the spirituals, and we're going to talk about the spiritual arrangements that were commissioned by Leontine Price. Bonds composed several spiritual arrangements, as we know, but the ones that were commissioned by Leontine Price probably gave her the most popularity and the widest audiences because many of them were recorded. The first recording was done in 1962, and it was called Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, 14 Spirituals, and that is this record right here. And I will pass this around too so that you can see this. These are original records. And then in 1971, there was another commission that came. And this one was Leontine Price again with the Rusk Choir College. And it was entitled, I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free. And I'll start this one on this side of the room. And that record, when I bought it, had never been opened. So, yeah, it's a brand new record. So, in an interview with James Hatch in 1971, which I believe we're going to be listening to, Bonds confessed that she often composed upon a request, but by doing so, she would know that her works would be performed. She also stated, I compose art songs, but I am more frequently commissioned to arrange spirituals. And although her art and popular songs contain similar musical elements, her spiritual arrangements are some of her most celebrated song compositions. Noteworthy American opera singers such as Adele Addison, Marian Anderson, Joyce Bryant, Hortense Love, Paul Robeson, and Leontine Price all performed these spirituals. And here is a quote from Lawrence Davidson, and he was a star of the opera, the Chicago Civic Opera, and he said this about Margaret Bonds' spiritual arrangements. Her spirituals have a quality and stamp that cannot be compared with those pseudo-purveyors of the Negro folk song. A genuine understanding of her people coupled with the intrepid musicianship combined to make the singer and listener share a memorable experience. From the singer's viewpoint, these songs have everything needed for successful concert numbers. Interesting material unusually presented, here is hope for the future of American music. So this is how much faith he had in Margaret Bonds' art songs and her arrangement, her spiritual arrangements. But like I said before, Leontine Price was the one singer that commissioned her the most. And Leontine Price stated that she knew of no other poetry or music which expresses the humility, the devout sincerity to our omnipotent as the American Negro spiritual does. These are beautiful songs which pour originally from the souls of people seeking for a better place, exclaiming their childlike belief in his wisdom and understanding, as well as portraying the patience of a people of great faith. And she says, the spiritual is a great American heritage, as truly American as apple pie or Boston baked beans. Spirituals are a musical expression of a great people who are great Americans. And that is actually a quote that was taken from the first spiritual record that Leontine Price ever made. And what I'd like to look at first is the Swing Low, Sweet Chariot 14 Spirituals record, and we're going to talk about some of these pieces. And these pieces probably were very special to Margaret Bonds, because I know that Dr. Ray Linda Brown had said earlier that Florence Price had a very strong faith. And I believe that Margaret Bonds did as well. She talks about how her mother and her and Florence would get together and they would pray. And they would win these competitions. So they said their prayers were powerful. And she obviously grew up in a heritage whereby she heard this music so often and studied with William Dawson, who of course started the Tuskegee Institute Choir and was an arranger of many choral spirituals. So here is the 14 spirituals. And if I could have that record back, who has that?
14 spirituals.